that in the times past, you've heard me talk about the purpose of street preaching, and I have always alluded to what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, "Think not that I've come to bring peace today, but rather a sword." And the problem is that a lot of times as preachers, we do tend to focus, and we can get focused on the minutiae of the ministry. And we fail to really incorporate into our thought patterns the larger, the higher strategic purposes of what we're doing. And so this message here, I'm going to try and focus on the larger strategic purposes in the Lord's strategy. Jesus said to his disciples, he says, "Unto you it's given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God." And I think that this is one of them. I think this is one of the secrets of the kingdom of God that God is letting us know now. But let's start with Matthew 24:14. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness, and then shall the end come. The question that arises, what is the end?
Yeah.
Here's a description of the end. The sun shall be dark and the moon shall not give a light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. Then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in power, in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. That's a description of the end. Now look at this. Question is, when is the end? Matthew 24:29, where this description starts, it says, "Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give light." So what does that tell us? The end is the pivot point. The worldwide preaching and the Great Tribulation occupy the same time period. They occupy the same time period. Now, you've heard me talk on Jesus' intention with the street preaching in Matthew 29, where he says, "Think not that I've come to bring peace, nay, but rather a sword, for I am come to set a man at variance against his father." And so I came to a conclusion that what Jesus is talking about in Matthew chapter 10 is what he's talking about in Matthew 24. It's the same period of time. And Matthew 10, of course, is the place where Jesus established the preaching ministry. And he told them what to expect. He told us right here, delivery ought to be affected. Now, I think, to me, the conclusion then is that there are some things I've concluded from it. One, that the tribulation period is a time of God's greatest glory. Why? The Bible says that judgment must first begin in the house of God, because the scriptures say that the church is the first to be judged. Now, where do you think that the judgment of the church is mentioned? There is a place where the actual judgment of the church is being described. It's not Matthew 25. And I contend that because Matthew 25 talks about how many groups are mentioned in the judgment in Matthew 25. Most people say two.
Sheep and goats.
Sheep and goats. That's not it. There's a third group. The third group is the least of these my disciples. That's the third group. And the reason I say it's a third group is because the scriptures at the point when this passage begins. Anyone, somebody turn to Matthew 25 for me, please.
Right here.
There's the third group. His holy angels. And to say that God is going to judge the people left on the earth on the basis of how they've treated heavenly beings is somewhat absurd. But what does the scripture say about the Lord's return? It says that when we see him coming in the air, what happens to the dead in Christ? And what happens to those who are left alive?
They're changed.
And what does Paul say? He says, so shall we ever be with the Lord. So at the time when Jesus returns, Matthew 25, the believers have already been taken out. And they've come back with him. They come back with the Lord. What?
Oh, no, go ahead.
Oh.
Sorry.
And so those who are being judged are being judged on the basis of how they treated this group Jesus refers to as the least of these, my brethren. Now, who does Jesus call his brethren? Not just Christians as a whole.
The preachers.
The preachers.
Preachers, there you go.
Those who do the will of the Father. Those are his brethren. Now, the word translated in King James angels is angelos, which has several other meanings. One of them is messengers, another is pastor.
That's right. It's true.
And so what we have here is a judgment which appears to be against those or for those on how they have treated the preachers.
Yes.
Now I'm going to narrow in down a little bit to the church and to give you what I consider to be a high level overview of the judgment of the church. Where is the judgment of the church mentioned? There's no place in there that is mentioned specifically, but it is mentioned in an offhand manner. In Matthew 10:34, it's where Jesus says, think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace with sword.
Amen.
For I have come to set a man at variance against his father, mother against daughter. Now, if you come down to verse 40, here's that the area where it corresponds somewhat with the judgment in Matthew 25. This is the judgment here, the judgment of the world. But look just above that. He that loveth father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross, followeth after me, is not worthy of me. Is that, or is that not a judgment? It is a judgment. The judgment is, are these people worthy of Christ? And the standard upon which they are judged is, will they take a stand for Christ? Just before Matthew 24, whosoever confesses me before men, him will I confess before my Father which is in heaven. Whosoever denies me before men, him will I deny before my Father which is in heaven. Think not that I have come to send peace on earth, nay, but rather a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and mother against daughter. And the daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. A man's foe shall be they of his own house. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me.
Amen.
That, my friends, is the description of the judgment of the church that must begin before the judgment of the world. And it does, at least positionally in this passage, that judgment of the church precedes the judgment of the world, which is 40, 41, and 42.
It also happens to be the same way that Psalm 7:11 is laid out. He judges the righteous.
Yes.
He's angry with the wicked.
And he's angry with the wicked.